feels better than it. Nothing feels better. Nothing feels better than it. Nothing feels better. But now friends, but I swear when nobody's around, you keep my hand around your neck. We connect, are you feeling it now? 'Cause I am. I got so hotter than that. I swear to God, from my feet and lift the ground. Oh yeah. This is all we've been talking about in my ears. And nothing feels better than this. Nothing feels better. Nothing feels better than this. Nothing feels better. I'm not.
Feel by the wayside, like everyone else. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I was just kidding myself. Our every moment, I started a place. 'Cause now that the corner lock, here were the words that I needed to say. When you...
Okay. Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Sharma.
My name is Renee To, and we are your hosts for today's Limitless Sharing Workshop.
That's right. We are Year 2 PR students from Thai UC and also the Committee of Love in Generosity, Hope and Time, L.I.G.H.T. Charity Campaign.
The purpose of organizing this event is to raise funds for our beneficiary, the ID My Academy, for their daily functions and to support their giving to the underprivileged, refugees, and homeless communities.
Our funds are raised for the ID My Academy so that they may allocate the funds to support their operational costs as well as continuing their mission to help the others. So, in support of the campaign, there are some programs and activities was planned, which also included this workshop that you are attending right now to raise the awareness for the disabled community.
Hence, you may donate towards our platforms of Touch & Go by scanning the QR code, or you may kindly donate through our second platform by scanning the Simply Giving website that is displayed on the screen. And the link will be provided in the chat box section. Any amount donated is greatly appreciated. Next, I would like to announce that the attendance form for the workshop will be provided at the end of the session, so make sure you stay tuned. Now, let us introduce
Mr. Wait, Renee, we forgot to tell our audience to check our others' activity and programs on our social media at L.I.G.H.T Charity Campaign on Instagram and Facebook. You guys may check out the social via the link that the committee have provided in the chat box. The link provided contains our others' activities, which are easier for you guys to check it out.
And now, without further ado, let us introduce our speaker for today, Mr. Melvin Tong. He is a cancer-surviving hip disarticulation amputee from Malaysia who believes that everything is possible. He had fibrosarcoma cancer, known as soft tissue cancer, on his right knee, which was amputated after 1 month of discovering this condition. More so, this had happened during his SPM year, which he did not give up, nor did he postpone taking his SPM.
Adding on, Mr. Melvin is also a Malaysia Book of Records holder for being the first amputee to conquer the Mount Kinabalu. Not only that, but he also climbed Mount Everest Base Camp before for raising money to support the education of the underprivileged children in Malaysia.
So now, let us welcome Mr. Melvin Tong.
Hi guys and girls.
Welcome Mr. Melvin Tong for joining us today. It is an honor to have you with us in conducting this workshop.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so let us start our session now. First of all, we would like to ask, when you lost your right leg at 17 years old due to cancer known as fibrosarcoma, what went through your mind, feelings, and how did you overcome it at such a young age? You know, what were the obstacles as a teen seeing that you had to go through such circumstances?
Well, I guess whenever events like this happen, it didn't happen immediately. So for my case is that I know that there has been a growth on my leg. So by the time I went to see the first doctor, I actually never expected that the word amputation was even alien to me. So it was something that you just don't expect it to happen. I mean, we all feel like we can live forever, and that was probably the feeling I had as a teenager. So this was right before I do my SPM, right before I enter college. So to me, it's like, ha, got problem, what can I do to solve it? What can I do to fix my leg? And the whole idea of cutting off a leg, right, was not there until the very end. So I guess the feeling was more of like, of course there is a bit of more of disbelief or shock. And that probably came more from my parents. My parents at that time, very last minute, when I told them that, hey, there's something wrong, really need to see different doctors to find out what I can do about it. Only that time they were more like, hey, you know what, we must do everything we can to save the leg. But I was more towards the acceptance of the situation and telling them that, hey, I think the best way is to go through the amputation, then I can have my life back to move on with this whole ordeal. Because I remember in a very short period, within the 2 months prior to my SPM, I have done 3 different biopsies on my leg, and I have seen over 10 different doctors. So that was taking the toll on me. That was more stressful than the idea of going through an amputation. Going to the problem with seeing doctors, I shared with my friends before, is that it's not like I go to the clinic and immediately I can see the doctor. I have to go make appointment, go to the hospital, drive all the way, and sometimes have to wait 1 hour or more just to see the doctor. And the consultation could be just a 20 minutes or 15 minutes thing. But that was very tiring to me, and I just wanted it to be over with. So I think the initial feeling, finding out that something like this is what I have to go through, it's more of preparing yourself with all the knowledge and different opinions from different doctors, so that you know what you are going, what options you have that you are going to take, and is the best option that you have. So I think for a lot of young adults like you guys, I'm sure that, you know, going for medical checkup or health check is not something common that you do. So maybe is to consider doing it once a year, if not every few years, just to find out some things that you are not sure, then you find out more about it.
I see. Well, because at 17 years old, normally people would be stressing about, you know, SPM. You know, every Malaysian at 17 years old would have to take SPM. So, but then when you found out about this cancer, how did you handle the pressure of juggling two major concerns of the SPM and also the news of the amputation?
When something traumatic happens, I think sometimes people tend to feel that they are at loss, but then you just have to pick yourself up and focus on it, like how you focus on your examinations. So just go through it one step at a time. Then you would be more ready to it. It's like, you know, sometimes it's like your time is inevitable that you have to face it either way. So you just have to face it regardless.
Then did you feel that losing a leg was part of like losing a huge part of yourself that was, you know, hindering you from exploring further or enjoying activities as a growing individual, because you were 17 only at that time?
Well, being a 17, just like you guys, right, I was definitely looking more to having more fun, going more paktor, meeting more friends and girls. And that was probably, you know, I want to play more games. It wasn't something about like what business or career and whatnot, although they were probably a hint of, okay, you know, what work can I do? What job can I take? And it's more like that moment is like, if it happens to you, like, what will my future be like? And I think it's the same for all of you. I think that now that you are in the second year of college, what would be your biggest fear when college ends? Do you have everything figured out? What are you doing right now? The world changes so fast that this whole pandemic changes so many things. Businesses started tens of years can just collapse just like that. If we don't adapt and change, then what can we do? So same question that you have to ask yourself is that, what are you going to do? What can you do?
So how did you do at that point? Like, do you have a personal story for this point that you have just mentioned?
Like how you motivate yourself to think positive?
I think that we have to allow ourselves to grieve if we need to grieve. So you probably heard of the five stages of grieving, and we still have to go through that somewhat. So I probably would be, very angry. Why this happened to me? And I probably would be like my parents who want to bargain about it, talk about how, you know, we can do other options, other alternatives. And you just have to imagine yourself. I mean, we think that we are extremely healthy, we go to sports, we exercise, but yet cancer is something that could hit anyone. I'm not trying to scare you, but what if this is something that happened to you? What would you do? What would your preparation be? What could you have done differently today? If you are the one who is losing a limb, whether it's one hand or in this case one leg, or heck, let's talk about even losing one thumb. Do you know that losing one thumb, you cannot even function with your hand? You try to hold a cup with just four fingers. Even just losing a thumb, your whole life will change. But how do you prepare for that? You cannot even type on keyboard properly. Yeah, you can still probably type slowly. You cannot play your games. No Dota, no nothing, no Counter-Strike, whatever the games that you guys are playing today. It changes everything. But then we as human beings, the only amazing thing is that if it happened to you already, for some reason, you will know how to make the best out of it. So I wouldn't say that I am extremely positive and it's like taking the whole thing, no problem, I can do it. I don't bullshit myself that way. But you can probably tell yourself that, yes, I can, yes, I can. Yeah, it probably bring your spirit up a little bit. But then reality doesn't change just like that. It may sound a bit bleak when I say it like this. But again, like I say, imagine yourself going through this. I don't think the feelings and emotions would be very much different. It's just that we have to be informed on what we need to go through, and then we make the best out of the situation. Does that make sense to you?
Yep, sir. So actually, I have a question. Is that during that the process, do you have a person like you would it's like you will like emulate him to as your one of your target to keep going? Do you have that kind of person like keep like as your role model?
Interestingly, I mean, it's funny how sometimes, right, when your whole life you've been normal. I mean, I lost my leg at 17, right? So as of today, I am more than twice the duration that I have had lost my leg. So this year I'm actually 36. So I lost my leg. The period I lost my leg is longer than the time I actually had the leg, had both my legs, right? And you see, is what I'm trying to say is funny is because people for some reason try to connect me with other people who are disabled after I lost my leg. So imagine this. I have friends who try to introduce me to another girl who lost her leg. I mean, I don't mind meeting another person who lost her leg to share experiences. I even have a group chat with other amputees, lah, to put it this way. But for them to think that, hey, if I lost my leg today, my group of friends should also be disabled people. The girl I date should also be a disabled girl. But why would people have that mindset to think that, hey, I want you to meet this person. She's also disabled. So I guess initially, instead of looking at role models, right? I guess it's usual for people to think that being disabled means that you are someone who needed help. You are someone who people, I guess people do sympathize more or be more easy and empathize on whatever you need, you want, right? They probably would say, hey, you want to cut the queue, I can let you go first. So you want to, it's like disabled parking, I can park disabled parking right in front of the shopping mall or whatever shops. So of course there are privileges that I get to enjoy. But if you were talking of role models, interestingly, at that time, there were a lot of people asking me to, oh, you have to find out this guy called Nick Vujicic. He doesn't have limbs. He is so inspiring. And for the longest time, I'm like, yeah, I heard of that guy. But just because now I lost a leg, should I be inspired by him? Does that make sense to you?
Yeah,
yes. I can see that I know a lot of inspiring people. Yeah, he lost his limbs. He can do a lot of things. That's good. Two thumbs up for him. and same to a lot of, also if I'm interested in other motivational gurus to successful businessmen, I'm sure all of you, I have a lot of inspiration. Like I follow Elon Musk and I find that he's really interesting, really funny. And of course, yeah, being the rocket man himself, who is also the richest, probably the second richest man in the world. So we are inspired by different things, and it shouldn't be just another disabled guy. I'm not asking you here today to be inspired by me, because I probably so somewhat look like I made it better, or I am able to cope with my life better. I think that life is pretty much the same with or without my leg. So same like you guys, you have to go through life in your own time frame, timeline. And some people may seem to be able to work things out a few steps faster than you, but it's to know that you have to give yourself the time, the experience you need to live on your life. So when you graduate, yeah, some of your friends, your classmates may probably get better positions, higher pay, and so on. And instead of looking down of yourself or be demotivated in any way, is to see that, hey, know that you all are given equal chance and opportunity in life. So what are you doing to make the best out of it? I was just sharing this with my girlfriend recently, actually. And I was telling her that, you know, when I was younger, I probably thought that, you know, I want to make more money. How do I make my first 100,000 ringgit? How do I make my first 1,000,000 ringgit? And it doesn't seem to end. So we all want to talk about like in this talk, we are talking of being limitless, being successful. Or in another word, simply say is to be filthy rich. But I think that is the mindset that a lot of people have it wrong. So what is success to you guys? Maybe as a student is to make sure that you, if not to score all distinctions for your subjects, it's actually just to pass all your exams. So different stage of time, we have different priorities. And if your target is actually thinking that you want to make a lot of money, then of course that is not the right mindset that you should have. As they say, you go do drugs, that's the most profitable, but is that the thing you want to do? So what is success? What is being positive? It's like, I'm sure that just as students right now, you have your ups and downs. Just like being in this pandemic, most of you have not even met each other in person. Probably you have met in person in some orientation or over a Zoom meeting or Google Meet like this. But things changed over the past 2 years. At least it was so much changes for me. And I never imagined myself able to stay in one place with minimal traveling for almost the entire year, or at least especially since this MCO started. And I'm sure it is the same for all of you, yet we all survive it. So if anything, good job to you guys too. I have to ask you back, wow, what motivate you, how you survive this staying at home thing? Because at some point I really feel that, wow, this is tough if I am alone. So how can I still mix with people, connect with people, and have what normal used to be?
For me, my opinion is that because like due to this pandemic, like many people cannot go back to the physical class. So I think that we shouldn't waste this period, because this period is also like quite a golden opportunity for us in this age. So I think that we should take advantage of using this age to like utilize this period to learn more things and explore more. Although it's on internet, but also they have different benefits. Yeah, this is my point of view.
I agree, because now we are at that time where technology is getting much more advanced, and it's not only limited to facing things physically. That's why there's devices like virtual reality, where we could also sort of to go out and travel in a virtual kind of situation. And maybe I agree with what Sharon said about taking advantage, because life is actually really short, and we should always take opportunity of each moment we have, because we never know, especially with this COVID-19 virus spreading around, we may never know what would happen. So that is my opinion.
Okay.
So moving on, where you said that you did not like where people try to stereotype you with the other disabled people. Am I right just now when you talk about how people introduce you to other girls who are also maybe disabled with without a leg? How do you feel when such situation occur? Do you have an honest opinion whenever people treat you this way?
I think sometimes when in that situation, for example, right, people think that you have something in common. So I guess to connect with another person, I'm fine with that. But for them to think that for some reason they probably think that this would be a good mesh. And then of course what I'm trying to say is that we are not limited to just that circle. Because I remember there was once I have to attend a dinner organized by Malaysia Book of Records. So they have this big event there. They have like over 100 tables there. And they actually put me in the table with 8 other disabled people. Half of them is on wheelchair. And the guy I'm seated beside, no offense, but he is holding the pee and shit bag, and I can literally feel as if I'm sitting beside the toilet bowl all night long. And I was talking, I spoke to the organizer after that, and they thought that, oh, it's a good idea to put all disabled people together. And I say that is the worst thing that you could do to put the entire group of OK user on one table. What that made me feel. So again, like I said, not so much of the fuller's fault holding the pee bag and the shit bag. But then it's like, why would people do that? You see, we all think that we know what is best for other people, but is that really the best decision? Of all the hundreds of record holders there, I am in one table with 8 other record holder or whatever is it. Okay, use one table in the corner. So I think that though, so to answer your question is like, you put yourself in my shoes and you tell me how you should feel. Should I feel love in generosity like what you just mentioned in this like charity campaign? It definitely doesn't feel like that to me. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. You just wanted to be treated equal. It's not having no leg or other disabilities. It's just a small part. That's because there's so much more to the person, you know. That's why there's the saying goes like, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, or don't judge a book by its cover. Yes, so
very nice.
We know all of these sayings, but then not everyone could actually put it into action. Do you agree?
Of course, definitely. I mean, if I were to relate to being 19-year-old or 20-year-old right now, my only concern, again, like I say, if I were a teenager like this, my only concern is what games can I play? Who can I go out with? Who do I want to date next, probably? What movie can I go out with to watch? And all these things that I want to play or do, right? So unfortunately, if I were to look back in my early 20s or even my college time, the being inclusive is not really there. People would recognize another disabled guy like me. Yeah, hi, no, that's Melvin. Oh, good. But we are always still not an equal in their eyes. So if I think if coming to that is more of, if each of you were to do this and to raise awareness, is to ask back ourselves what we can do to be really open to people different to us. Regardless, I think disability comes in different form. Just as one would think that they are not pretty enough, too fat, too thin, too whatever. So we all feel disabled in some way. How we are unable to connect with other friends, other groups. Why some days, like we even put them in different groups, like the cool kids group, the nerdy groups, and so on. So yourself, we in school right now especially, find out how you can really say to be inclusive and to treat each other with love and respect. And not to push them to one corner, like what I say, how these organizers, they call themselves Malaysia Book of Records, but the organizing, the worst thing that can happen for someone who is OKU. That, I mean, at least that was my own opinion. They I spoke to them, they apologize and all, but I think the damage is done, right?
Yeah. Apologize already cannot like clue the damage already. So from my view, I think that actually I remember once you have said before is we are not handicapped by the disability, but we are handicapped by the social society. So I think that actually we are not disabled because of the disability, but it's because, but we don't want to like, we don't want to have the disability attitude. So I remember got one sentence you said, if you take away the limit, then everything is possible. So can you please share with us that how you came to this point of realization? Like, when did you start to challenge your limit and instead of being limited to yourself?
I mean, I remember being in my finishing high school to starting college. And I remember this is the time, as you guys, your age right now, is the time that I feel most energetic, that everything is really possible. So if there is a time where you can really do anything, it's actually right now. Before you finish your college, and right when you so-called come out from your college, whether you want to try different things, try learn a new skill to starting a small little enterprising or business, right? Even selling cookies to selling cakes. This is the time that you should go and explore this. So I have to say that, you know, it's okay to be a bit lost and clueless, especially when you just graduated. Whatever the course that you are taking now, you probably may even feel that this is not what you want to do, but you are 2 years in, too late to change. Finish this before you start something else. You can do a lot of short courses after this even. So you can still go into a completely different profession after being in one for a couple of years. There is no such thing as, you know, you are stuck with one thing. I remember I started off with many different things, including what they call like the direct marketing to insurance, to all these things that people like you, young people nowadays, will say no to. So easy, reject first. But then what have you tried? Do you even give an opportunity to listen, to learn? What can you do? What can you do to make your so-called your first 100,000 ringgit, for example? And I was just sharing this at another friend. Even if you save 5,000 bucks a month, it will still take you almost 2 full years to save 100,000. So if you think that you could do better, you have to come up with different business plans or something more than just your first job is able to give you. So, yep, I think that one is something for you to think about.
By exploring things, could I ask what things did you explore at around our age? Like, do you have any stories that you could share, for example, you know, just to put things into perspective for our audience?
Right, yes. So when I was in my teenagers, at 15 years old, I really started building websites. And from a simple personal blog with my name and telling people that this is time before even we have Facebook or any social media of that kind. Before even what Friendster or MySpace, even before that time, this is like before year 2000. So it's interesting that at that time, when I started making, very shortly after making a personal blog-like website, I started making a gaming website. I was very much into playing this game called Need for Speed. And I think the franchise is still around strong 20 over years later. And from there, I got very curious about like upgrading PCs and computer, right? And I started a website writing about computer hardware. So that was what I started on in my teenage years, between the age 15 to all the way to 20 years old. And that actually, helped me make a good sum of money, I guess. And interestingly, after college time, as I mentioned just now, I even explored into direct marketing, multi-level marketing, MLM. So I go and explore, go and listen. Like until today, I am still doing insurance for cars mostly. So things that you may put tell people, it's like, wow, no way. But yet, it's something that you can probably start and explore. I tried many different businesses after that. Of course, now, even like right now, I'm doing like a rental to leasing business. Besides still selling some cars, still working on my car workshop, and other businesses that I'm involved with, to microfinancing, micro loans that I provide to people. But at your age, it's more of just be open to let yourself try different things. And I recently seen a friend whose sister is also in college right now, started her own bakery, selling cookies, selling things that she just baked from home. And from your first sale, from your friends eating your food to selling more product, that is where you learn the ropes of the business. That's how you learn, okay, what can I do next? Do I do your marketing from Instagram or from Facebook or from even TikTok and so on? So you try different things, and I guess this is the age where you are adult enough to take charge of your life, to start something on your own. It's not to wait until you finish college and then worry about finding your first job. If anything, I would say that I would always push for young adults like you guys to go start something now. Creating a website will now take you just 10 minutes if you want to fill in the blanks, put in a title, and you improve it over the next couple of hours. In 2 days, you can probably launch it. You can buy a domain name for just what? Yeah, it costs $10, so 40 ringgit there. But the 40 ringgit, you have a website. If you do not want to even spend that money, never mind. Just create a Facebook page. Share the link with all your friends. Out of the 1,100 students you have here, you just need your first 5 customers to say, okay, I support you. And I say, if you have that mindset of supporting each other, almost 100 of you here can probably come up with something simple. Just like how I shared about fundraising, was it yesterday or 2 days ago. If everyone collectively come up with something, you achieve your goal immediately. It's a freaking joke to tell me that 100 of you can't even raise 10,000 ringgit after how long since this campaign started. So you don't have your mind to put into something and you are dreaming of making your 10,000 ringgit paycheck, right? So when you look at things become smaller, then it becomes more, you know, make it into an achievable goal that is so small that it's easy to achieve. So I will tell you again, share with you again, for this light charity campaign, each of you just need to raise 100 ringgit per person by hook or crook. If you don't, you take out from your pocket. This will make sure that you will reach your target from day one itself. Not at the end of campaign, then you try to tell me that, Alvin, I think you have almost raised slightly more than half now. Have you reached 7,000 ringgit yet?
Yes, almost very, very soon, actually.
So it's still 6,000 something, right?
6,900 something. Good. At this point.
So to me, is that day one already achieved target. Now your focus should be on doubling it.
Yeah, correct.
It's the same thing what I'm trying to say is there are so many things, so many ways you can do something to get things done. So my challenge, if anything to you, is start with this charity campaign, double it by end of this campaign, not just target 10K. You are set, instead of setting such a low bar to yourself, give yourself a higher bar.
Yes, we will try our best, definitely, because we also we do not aim to stop only at 10K. Of course, we would try to want to reach our best limit or our best achievable goal. And as what you have said just now, I agree that, you know, exploring things is quite essential, you know, for our knowledge as part of our growth, because I'm not sure if you know this, but there's a saying in Chinese called 活到老学到老, which means that as long as you live, you can learn. Because if we are so ignorant of exploring things and that we stay cooped in just one area, we won't be able to achieve great heights ahead. Do you agree? Did I sum up your point correctly?
Yes, pretty much. I agree.
Yeah. So now I'll pass to Shereen.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you for sharing the personal story. And now we would like to move to the next part, which you are quite well known of, the story of how you hide the Mount Kinabalu. And with this, we would like to ask that, what was your preparation for the Mount Kinabalu? Like, how long did you take to prepare before embarking on the Mount Kinabalu? And was the training preparation as any you can share?
Okay, let me try to share some pictures from an old presentation I have.
Wow, that's amazing.
While we wait, we would also like to explain more to our audience first. So Mr. Melvin has climbed Mount Kinabalu and also climbed Mount Everest
base camp
to raise funds for the
underprivileged children.
To support the education of the underprivileged children in Malaysia. So for those that are much more curious about this story, you guys could try to think of a question and maybe you guys can type it up in the chat box below later and we could ask Mr. Melvin.
I will be right back. I will just reopen this.
Sure. In the meantime, I think, yes, Mr. Melvin is back. So... Mr. Melvin, are you presenting? Yeah.
Yeah, he's presenting now. Wow.
Mr. Melvin, I think you muted your mic.
Yep.
Okay. How do I put this up? Can you see this?
Yep, yes. You can see.
Okay, so yeah, this is the first picture. It's a picture I took when I actually test drive my friend's manual car. This was taken like 2 days before I had my right leg amputated. So I think a lot of things that we thought that we wanted to do, and I asked myself what I want to do before I have my leg cut off, right? So one of the things that I remember doing is to learn how to drive even before I got my license. And I think that coming back immediately is to talk about climbing mountains is that it was never a challenge that I envisioned myself wanting to do to prove to anyone or anything, but it just happened so that it became something that I thought that I could do. And that was how Mount Kinabalu came about. If you look at this picture, this was actually the south peak of Mount Kinabalu. And it's the same one in the old 1 ringgit note that they show the mountain, this exact spot there. And it's just like right now, I mean, in school, in college, is there a challenge so difficult that you want to do just so that you know that you can do it? It's like, would you want to maybe be the first in class or be the top scorer in the subject or to just achieve something that you felt that it is something that is possible but you haven't do it? And I think this is exactly what I'm trying to say on your first mountain. Find something that you want to do, but instead of giving you that usual convenient excuses of not to do it, to go and pick one challenge and pick it up and do it. So of course, climbing Mount Kinabalu gives me all this benefit, like I get featured in magazines, to having getting into this book of records. That's why I'm here today, right? And having MTV3 to do even an entire episode in MHI to cover this story. You can see that's taken at the top of Mount Kinabalu. And of course, climbing Mount Kinabalu is just a 2 days thing, but it's still one of the probably a very difficult mountain that every Malaysian should go and attempt to climb. And shortly after climbing Mount Kinabalu, I thought that, hey, what are the other things as a one-legged man could actually do? And I, very shortly after that, in 2011, I went and skied for the first time, took my diving license and went diving. I'm still diving a lot until last year, actually. And I think these are like, what are the fun things, fun and games that you can do that at the same time give you a good reason to live? And shortly after that, I thought that, hey, you know, I like cars. And people ask me, you know, I think all boys and girls in some way, we probably started off in college if we are lucky enough to even have our parents give us an old car to use to go school. But probably right now you are just studying and work from home, right? So you probably won't think about car too much. But back then, you know, having a car to move around, to meet friends, to yum cha, to do your things. And I wonder, it's like, what can you do? What can I do for me to play nice cars? And I thought that, hey, instead of trying to have that whole conventional mindset of saving money and buying your car, and I thought, hey, if I am in the industry, then I can access to any cars much more easier. And that was why I started doing a car business with my brother. So we imported all the supercars and luxury cars and sell them in in KL here. At the same time, shortly after that, we also brought in our the first brand new limousine in Malaysia. So I believe until right now, you probably still won't see many limousines around. But most of the limousines, if you do see any, most likely came from my company.
I see, yeah. I see. So,
any questions so far?
I want to ask then, what actually made you want to be successful in life? Given your circumstance, we feel that maybe being successful or having the mindset of being successful, what made you come into that perspective?
I think being different probably motivated me to try to stand out from the normal people more. So I was probably still exploring, finding out who I am myself. And of course, what I have been probably was doing back then is trying to make myself different. So in a way is that make myself recognized for more than just being another disabled guy. And that was probably the reason why I do all the crazy things from climbing mountains to probably like doing a car, supercar limousine business like this. So, and to put it easily, it's more like, yeah, I probably wanted to go after the nicer and finer things in life. And it's like, I'm sure that, you know, if you are in school, you probably want the, it's like just now I was just reading the news that iPhone 13, new Apple Watch, and probably new MacBook or new MacBook Air. All this is coming, launching in September by Apple. And they are constantly new toys, new gadgets, new things that we want. So how can I get them? How can I achieve them? And I don't want to be the guy saving all year just to buy a phone, for example, you see. So it was more like that drive and that need to achieve something. And what can I do to get that, to get there? So I'm sure it is the same question you're asking is like how and why. So I don't have an answer to this question directly, but in short, all I can say is to really just to go all out while you still have the time and energy to actually just do whatever is it to explore new things, to try new things. As I say, if I want to drive a nice car, before this supercar and limousine business, what I did was I was just working as a car salesman in a local dealer with a lot of cars. So that was how I started before I opened my own company, starting importing one car at a time. So to counter that problem, come to this second mountain that I call it mountain of unknown fear, right? Is that you have this fear of even like, for example, even going after a girl you like or a boy you like, you know, you do not know, you are afraid of rejection, you are afraid of failure. And we do not know what kind of, you know, rejection we will get and not getting what we want. And we will feel sad, we will feel shame, we will feel demotivated. So it's more like, how can you face this mountain of unknown fear? So for me, it was like, okay, I find something that is extremely difficult for me to do. Like in this case, I went for the Everest base camp 5 years after I climbed Mount Kinabalu. And I can find out that, okay, Everest is probably the most difficult I can go for and I can do. And I find out what are the options I have. Then I go for it. Because knowing that if I do the most difficult thing that my mind can imagine and able to do it, then nothing else can stop me after that.
And of course, if you can see the second picture of this slide, is that while whatever crazy things you do involve other people and do it for a good cause. So that's why in the picture you can see under the Malaysian flag, we raised over 100,000 for different charity homes for a good cause. So do something that challenge yourself all the way. At the same time, I brought my friends. I have two very close friends who climb with me together with everyone, all Malaysian in the picture, except one guy. One guy. So all of us are Malaysian who went to the base camp together. And how one event leads to another, right, is that I didn't know that right after I came back, less than 10 days after I got back from the Everest base camp, there was this huge earthquake in both Mount Kinabalu and in Nepal as well. So fortunately, we were all back safely, and it gave us an opportunity to know what kind of aid and support that we can give to people who lost their homes, especially. But then, as I was talking of, you know, as we challenge ourselves for more mountains, one of the difficult things is that from time to time, this was a picture I took from one of my MRI scan, actually. This was actually a real picture from my MRI scan. So it was very scary that, you know, when I go back for my scan to be told that, hey, they could be a recurrence to your cancer. So knowing that each of us have limited time in our life, what can we do in this short period? I had this discussion recently where we talk about if suddenly you know that you will die in a matter of days, what do you think will go through your mind? Regrets that you have, the goodbyes that you haven't say, the sorries that you haven't share or tell?
Yeah, I think it's like we need to like cherish what we have the time now and do whatever we wanted to be and explore more. Did I sum up the point clearly? Right?
So we all think again, like, I mean, I say probably right now even, we think we have a lot of time to slowly build or grow and to slowly live our life and enjoy. But what if time is much shorter than what you imagine? You know, right now, from the time that you started your first day in school to right now, is less than, let's say, another year maybe for you to finish schooling, finish college. What is your mountain next? So that one you have to find out. You have to constantly ask yourself. And oh yeah, in this picture, you can see the picture I took, the third picture with the two friends I went up to climb the mountain with. So all these pictures were actually taken in Nepal itself with my friends. And that was the one nice big meal that I had right before we fly to Nepal.
Oh, I see. Then you said be thankful equals to celebrate success. Then do you think that in order to be successful, is it better to be naturally skilled at birth, like having a natural talent for it, or is it much more important to work hard for it? Because there's a saying that work smart, not work hard. But everyone may not be gifted with smarts or privileges. What is your view on this?
I suppose even if we still have to work hard, then only we can able to learn how to work smart. Does that make sense?
Yes, that makes sense.
Yeah, so initially, maybe I do not know how to do something. It probably take a lot of time to do it. But after doing it a few more times, I know the ways around it, then it saves time. So with experience, definitely you would be able to do something easier. I mean, it's just like climbing mountains. If any of you have climbed any mountains, you know that it doesn't mean that today you decide to climb, tomorrow you go Mount Kinabalu. It doesn't work like that. And it most probably will not even be able to reach the top if you don't prepare yourself, your body, your mind, and your soul for the task ahead. So it's more like constantly, if you are in that state of preparation for something bigger, more difficult, then you would be able to constantly improve yourself to achieve your goal.
Then do you mean that in order to reach or achieve the goal, it is necessary to go through trial and error?
Definitely. I mean, even we cannot know everything immediately. It's just like, I know that if I wanted to climb Everest Base Camp, so I have to have an idea on what that climb is all about. And this is, imagine you have to walk and climb every day for at least 8 full hours for the next 2 weeks to 3 weeks. So my trip in total was a 21-day trip. And the number of days we climbed from the bottom to the top and back to the bottom, it took us like almost 17 days. So if your body is not conditioned to walk and climb every day, you probably would give up. If not after the first day, maybe after the second day, because your body just cannot take it. So coming back, I mean, remember how I talk about Nick Vujicic? This was actually the picture I took with him right after he landed in Malaysia. So I find that instead of people always asking me to read his book or watch some of his videos, I was a bit more extreme. So I thought that, how about I bring him to Malaysia to motivate Malaysians instead? And that was what I did. So I brought him to Malaysia, invited him and his team, and he gave talks to thousands of people. This was 8 years ago, almost 8 years ago, yes. He came twice to Malaysia and one more time after 2 years after that. So of course, in this old slide that I have, hope that you enjoy it.
Of course, we did. So now we want to move on to another aspect, which is self-management. For this part, I would pass to my partner, Shane.
Okay, so for the self-management, I want to ask that, sir, like, all of us now is like experiencing stress one way or another. So can you share about some ways that how you manage your stress?
I think I probably reached this time of my life that I think we will have different things that stresses us every day. Probably get used to it. I mean, it's like we get used to firefighting problems. So every day we have different issues that we need to solve. New problems, like in my case, if in business, I probably have some car issues or payment issues. So what are the things that I need to constantly do? So it becomes part of our life or part of my life in this case to deal with all these car issues. So for someone who is not familiar, maybe you have a car, right? What would you do if suddenly your car came out an engine warning light or suddenly a tire busted? So if you are not used to it, you may feel very stressed by it. But if you are used to the routine, it's like in my case, every day I have at least two cars sent to the workshop. just to either service or repair something. If not car sent to workshop for routine maintenance, it could be because of I have a car accident. Like last night, I just have another car, have to call the insurance company, towing all the way from one place to another to the workshop. So to me, that is a daily routine. But this is for managing dozens and dozens of cars. So if you know how to manage your own one car, imagine you have to manage 100 cars in this case. So we learn how to do things and we improve over time. So I guess when it comes to stress is that I probably don't feel as much stress as I have compared to my younger days. So if anything, I think school and examinations, assignments is one good way that you have been continuously exposed to the stress in school right now. Just like organizing an event, getting all these students to come on time to attend the session. I think organizers will have their own stress. Students attending here, which I probably believe half of them is probably maybe just doing something else, mute their voice and mute their webcam just to show attendance. And I understand all this psychology on, in general, we all do that. So I that's why I hope that this session, you all are able to pick something from me, from my sharing. Besides questions from you, I'm actually very open to even any questions. If you are too shy to even speak out in voice, you can type a question in the chat section there. And I'm be very happy to share my point of view or my story per se.
Yeah, so our audience can ready. Later we have a Q&A section for you guys to ask questions to Mr. Melvin. So Mr. Melvin, I have a question here. Like just now you have said about school. How would you advise the student on to focus and capitalize on what they good and learn new things to adapt the situation? And like how to like do with your weaknesses? Yeah.
I suppose like any time of our own life, in my life even, right? If I want to ask myself, okay, what can I do now? Say, what can I do to make a side hustle to make extra income? What can I do? And it always like a bit of a blank. And I want to tell you that it's okay to feel like that. So it's okay to feel that you have nothing much to offer or nothing much you can buy or sell or give. And that is okay. But it's more of knowing that, you know, simple ways of how things work. So if you do not know how to, say, bake cookies, make cookies or brownies or whatever, cake even, I'm sure you learn, you have other skills that you can offer. Something simple. If you is all of you in the same course, same, or come in different courses all around the school?
I think based on the registration form that we have received, it is actually based on KL branch campus and also our Penang branch campus and from different faculties as well.
Okay, so there are students from every different background, whether it's engineering to say computers or marketing, communication.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct.
So just the same thing on whatever skill you have pretty much learned in your college the past 2 years. I believe most of the students here are second year, right?
Not limited to second year, but I think mostly should be from second year students.
So good. My good question. One whole year in college, what you learn? Maybe the first thing you can do is to something like that. It's like I met one guy who say he doesn't know how to no skill in all the things that a lot of things that he say he do not know. But I know he can draw like cartoon very, very nicely. So I say, hey, why not you just offer people to draw in hand whether on your iPad or your Illustrator or whatever app there is, right? And you sell your drawing. So he actually offered to sell to people directly, 50 ringgit one drawing. And I thought that, hey, that is very cute. It's like a cartoon-like picture of the whatever the person want to them to draw. In my case, I asked them to draw portraits and so on. So it's something small and achievable that you exchange maybe an hour of your time, you do it, and you get the rewards just like that. Or even recently, another friend who does painting, sell it on the blockchain to NFT. So to through the Ethereum blockchain. So that is something that other, I mean, students like you, if you are in the creative line, can explore as well. I think I read of a Malaysian selling his collection for over R1 million recently. So that was something that, wow, okay. Instead of thinking of how you make your $1 million from a few paintings, start from something small, something simple.
Mm.
So businesses is something that you can, for business students especially, I would say forget the whole business plan, business model that the school may teach you to create, but instead just immediately create a page in Facebook or in Instagram, make an Instagram account, put in 9 pictures and just blast it out. Tell people, support me. That's it. You have 100 students, just blast it to 100 students. I started this.
I would say
give away some samples, even if you want to. 5 of you get free sample, try it. And if it is good, just help me share it. So it's not difficult to start something, but rather we want to put in the time and effort to build something of our own.
Understood. It is to capitalize on our own strengths, and even if it's something small, which could eventually be built bigger in the end. Am I correct? Yeah. So I think that is the end of our sharing session. So now we will start with our Q&A session with the audience. I hope that the audience has prepared some questions for our speaker. So don't be shy and just ask, because I believe that Mr. Melvin is also eager to answer all your questions.
Okay, so for those of you who would like to ask questions, you can either press the raise hand button or write your questions in the chat box and we will read it out to Mr. Melvin to answer. Okay, so you guys may start asking questions now. So for the first question from Zhongjian Yuan. During that time where you invite Nick Wujicic to come over Malaysia, did you expect him to accept the invitation?
Sometimes we think that it is very difficult for us to reach all these prominent people. Like, say, for example, maybe today you say, okay, I want to message Taylor Swift. Of course, you cannot go directly to Taylor. They get spammed by all these fans and messages. So similarly, once we talk about it, once we actually have the desire to reach out to certain people, for some reason, we will be able to connect to the right person. So in this case, we probably have to connect with an agent who represents Nick so that we can actually propose what we have for him and see whether he accepts it or not. So likewise, whether it's just like how you want to reach out to me, if anything is not difficult, it's just to find the name and send me a message. In most cases, that one message is enough to reach someone. But of course, for someone bigger, more prominent, there is always a chance that you have to go through a few persons before you reach directly to them. But then, of course, if to answer the Zhongjian's question, right, is that we don't expect anyone to accept anything, but then we work out something that makes sense to them that they would have no issue accepting. So it's not always about offering or top dollars to invite them, it's not. But it's more like sharing why you are doing something.
Yeah. So now I think we have our Miss Josephine, which is also our event lecturer advisor. Miss Jo, could you open up your mic?
Hi, Melvin. I'm so sorry. My camera has a little bit of issue, so I can't switch on my camera.
No problem.
I'm Josephine, their event lecturer and also advisor. So I totally resonate with everything you say, especially when you say that 10,000 ringgit is very achievable and actually it's a very low amount. I totally agree with that. And I like that you said that, because their initial amount is half of that amount. So I was like, that is too easy.
Yes. So it's because more like indirectly forcing each student to take out 100 ringgit, yep, whether they use their own money or they raise the money. So I think, yep, that is one way to look at it.
Yeah, yeah. So I told them we need to have a higher target, because if there is no higher target, then they have no motivation to work harder and there's no challenge. So I like that you talk a lot about that. I also like the part where you talk about the NFT. I think a lot of you all do not know what is NFT. It's non-fungible tokens, okay, which is related to cryptocurrency, whereby you can sell art if you are good in art and also know how to design anything. Actually, you don't have to be very good, but you can just go up into many cryptocurrency platforms and just put up there and make money from there. So I think what Mr. Melvin is talking about, that is something that is very current, which a lot of students are actually not exploring.
Yes.
So I like that you brought this up, because people should explore all avenues to break the boundaries. So thank you very much for bringing it up. I have a question for you, Mr. Melvin. It is related to mental health, okay? Because, you know, this is such a huge thing going on with mental health here and there. I have my own personal stand on what mental health should be like and not be like, because I feel sometimes people use mental health as an excuse rather than pushing themselves beyond the boundaries. I'm not sure if you feel that way, but from what I see, based on news, based on celebrities, based on Hollywood, you know, Hollywood is not a very good example sometimes, and how students are going through this pandemic and everything, and not only students, but many family members, and a lot of them cite mental health as one of their boundaries, which may be true, but may I know what's your take on mental health and also maybe ways to overcome it or something?
When it comes to mental health, I have to say that I don't disagree that it is a very true and real thing that a lot of people are facing. I probably can't say that for myself. So when I have issues or problems, I am someone who wants to find out why I'm feeling like that and what I can do to get out from that problem, instead of letting myself dwell into that whole anxiousness or sadness or emotional attack that I would feel. So instead of letting myself feel I'm losing control of myself, I try to definitely find what can I do to get out of it.
Yeah.
So I think it is fair to say that we all have different ways of dealing with problems. We all feel our emotions, the anxiety when we come to different things that we have to face differently. So people may think that, hey, Melvin, you seem to be able to face it easily. It's not. It definitely doesn't just come easily like that. It's more of like knowing that, hey, if I don't pick myself up, who else can? Are you expecting someone else to do it for you? It's just like everyone wants to make your 1 million ringgit or whatever. You expect people to give it to you or how? It doesn't happen like that. So you have to start somewhere. And I think it's best to know what the root cause of the problem is.
Yep.
And we start in a very small way of what we can do about it. So making small changes or small goals.
Yeah. Rather than just telling yourself like, oh, I have mental health issues, and then just succumb to it and then have the mental health issues or whatever negativity that people go through to to change their identity. Rather than doing that, we take small steps to climb out from where we are. It's just like what you did when you go to KK, Mount KK, you take every step. You have no idea whether you reach. Your goal is, I want to reach there, but I have to focus on every step before reaching there.
Yes. And one interesting thing about climbing mountains, right, is that we all think of just reaching the top, but you have to always remember that reaching the top is exactly just 50% of the target.
Exactly. Yeah.
So reaching the top is halfway there only.
Yep. It's the whole process, right?
Correct. So yeah. I always tell people it's not about able to reach the top, it's to make sure you can go all the way back down, which is your 100%.
Yep. So what I tell my students, I say, getting A is fantastic, but getting A is not everything. So it's a whole process. If you just if by hook or by crook, you just get A, but you didn't learn anything in the process, then there's no point journeying all the way to get an A. But if you get an A plus you have learned something, of course, that's the best lah.
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Melvin. I'll let you move on to next questions with my students.
Sure. Any students okay. want to talk over voice also can actually.
Okay, so we are accepting the last question from Ichi. He said she said hi Mr. Melvin, would you mind to share some ways on boosting self-confidence? Thank you.
I actually was one of those students in college that I remember back in those days, we have to attend classes in lecturer's hall in the conference room. And from time and time, we have to even do some presentations on the stage. Yeah, I kid you not when I say that in college, I was one of those students who was really scared of doing presentations. I would probably go up in front of the class even though with all the same students I've been seeing all year long, and I would still stutter and my mind went blank, and I probably would in always say that, you know, I just don't have that confidence to share or to do the presentation. So it is okay to have that fear that, you know, we were talking about facing our fear, right? So is acknowledging and knowing that you have that confidence issue is perfectly okay, because in many times we just avoid that whole thing. It's like, okay, I don't like meeting people. So you already, your mind is made into, okay, if come to jobs, I don't want to do sales job. I don't want to do job that talk to people. Like, I don't want to do jobs that that require interaction. And then you end up maybe taking jobs like behind the office, in an office desk job, like being in HR or something, that you probably don't have to face a lot of people, don't have to sell something to people. So I think it's more like good thing is, you know, you have that confidence issue, and knowing that means there is something that you can do about it. So face that fear, and if anything is to identify what is it that you are not confident about yourself, is it in speaking? Is it in your looks? Because all these things, you can do something about it. If you think you are fat, maybe you lose weight. If you think that your face, I don't know, a lot of pimples, maybe you make sure you go take proper treatment, see a skin doctor. If you feel you cannot talk, there are so many even online YouTube videos teaching you how to speak. I personally have not taken any speaking or language course to speak to you guys. I find that one of the best way to share is just to share naturally, like a conversation like this, and that is the most honest and most direct that what I can do. That's why the slides I brought up also, I probably just share everything within 10 minutes or 15 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So as Yichi said, thank you very much for your advice. So I think that is all. Let's give a big round of applause to our speaker, Mr. Melvin, for sharing his valuable insight with us.
Yeah. So guys, yeah, type clap in the comment section to show your applause. Okay, well, I think that was a really amazing sharing section, and I'm pretty sure that all of you are motivated and inspired.
Yep, okay.
Okay, so now we are at the near end of this workshop session, but we have some good news for you.
We have a good morning voucher for our audience today, and this voucher can be used as a discount to buy nutritious product or supplement via the good morning website given in the chat box, or you can also scan the QR code that we have provided on the slide.
Once again, we also have two platforms available for your contribution if you are interested in donating. You can scan the Touch & Go QR code provided on the screen or head on to our Simply Giving website by scanning the QR code or by clicking in the link provided in the chat box.
Next, do follow us on our social media at L.I.G.H.T Charity Campaign on Instagram and on Facebook. You may also scan the QR code provided here to check out our other activities and programs that we have going on.
Speaking of activities, we have some attractive prizes waiting for you, such as the Xiaomi Compact Bluetooth speakers for our Try Your Luck Lucky Draw and the Redmi smartwatch for our Winner Winner Chicken Dinner Lucky Draw. To participate in this lucky draw, all you have to do is participate in 4 or 8 activities, workshops or challenges and screenshot them as evidence. Then, a submission form for this virtual activity card will be provided on our social media soon for you to participate in this lucky draw.
Moving on, we also have our Mafia program, which will be conducted this Saturday and Sunday on the 4th and 5th September 2021 at 8:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. This is one of our fundraising activities to raise funds for our beneficiary, the ID My Academy. The entrance fee is only at 4 ringgit. So gather your friend and join us by scanning the QR code that provided on the screen.
That is all from us. And once again, thank you so much, Mr. Melvin, for sharing with us today. And also thank you all for participating in our sharing workshop. I hope you guys learned something new today. And before you go, kindly prepare yourselves for our photo taking session soon.
Thank you all for joining us and have a great day ahead.
Okay, everyone, so please prepare to turn on your camera.